Pekah, king of Israel, son of Ramallah, went up to attack Jerusalem, but they were not able to conquer it. When word came to the house of David that Aram was encamped in Ephraim, the heart of the king and the heart of the people trembled, as the trees of the forest trembled in the wind. Then the Lord said to Isaiah, "Go out to meet Ahaz, you and your son Shear-Jabbah, at the end of the conduit of the upper pool, on the highway of the fuller's field, and say to him, 'Take care that you remain tranquil and do not fear. Let not your courage fail before these two stumps of smoldering brands, because of the mischief that Aram plots against you, saying, "Let us go up and tear Judah asunder, make it our own by force, and appoint the son of Tabeel king there." Thus says the Lord, "This shall not stand, it shall not be. Damascus is the capital of Aram, and Rezin is the head of Damascus. Samaria is the capital of Ephraim, and Ramali's son the head of Samaria. But within 60 years and 5, Ephraim shall be crushed, no longer a nation. Unless your faith is firm, you shall not be firm." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
God upholds his city forever.
God upholds his city forever.
Praise the Lord and holy to be praised in the city of our God. His holy mountain, fair as the heights, is the joy of all the earth.
God upholds his city forever.
Mount Zion, the recesses of the north, is the city of the great king. God is with her castles. Renowned is he as a stronghold.
God upholds his city forever.
For lo, to kings assemble, they come on together. They also see and at once are stunned, terrified, routed.
God upholds his city forever.
Quaking sees them, anguish like a woman's in labor, as though a wind from the east were shattering ships of Tarshish.
God upholds his city forever.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
If today you hear his voice, harden not your hearts.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Reading from the Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord.
Jesus began to reproach the towns where most of his mighty deeds had been done, since they had not repented. Woe to you, Chorazin. Woe to Bethsaida. For if the mighty deeds done in your midst had been done in Tyre and Sidon, they would long ago have repented in sackcloth and ashes. But I tell you, it will be more tolerable for Tyre and Sidon on the day of judgment than for you. And as for you, Capernaum, will you be exalted to heaven? You will go down to the netherworld. For the mighty deeds done in your midst had been done in Sodom. It would have remained until this day. But I tell you, it will be more tolerable for the land of Sodom on the day of judgment than for you. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Jesus is now going back to these towns that he had already been in and had already accomplished great works. He is perhaps healed the sick, maybe given sight to the blind, hearing to the deaf, healing to cripples, or whomever and whatever. They had witnessed his power. They had heard his powerful and moving words. They were attracted to him and perhaps followed him to a certain point. But then they sort of just relapsed. There was a certain joy at first, excitement, and then they just kind of went back to their former ways of life. And we see this time and time again through the history of Israel as a nation and a people of God, and also for us personally as Christians, and Christians throughout the world, throughout the ages. We are challenged every time we hear the gospel, and every time we celebrate the sacraments, to leave sin behind and to embrace Christ and live the gospel. And it's a enough of the world to have the comfort and the pleasure and the power or whatever it is that we want in this world. But our Lord wants us complete. He doesn't want half-hearted Christians, half-hearted followers. And this is oftentimes what led Israel into trouble. They would mix and mingle with pagans and other nations and start taking on to themselves the practices of the pagans. And little by little, their own faith is watered down, much like our own Christian faith has been watered down throughout the ages, most especially the past few decades. We see even mainline Protestantism that, for the most part, was on the same page with Catholicism in its moral teachings, whether it was about contraception or abortion or divorce or any number of other things. But gradually, quite quickly, really, many of them have embraced the culture of the world and the new morality that the world has been teaching, in contrast to what the scriptures have taught us and what the church has taught us as an authentic teacher given to us by Christ. We can do much the same. We can water down our faith and sort of make accommodations for the world and for the paganism and hedonism and so forth that the world has embraced. But we are called to a much higher level, to be saints, to be like God. And the fathers of the church understood this clearly, so that they said we were gods, the small g, because of the sacramental life, because of the incarnation, God becoming man, taking humanity to himself, to his divinity, and inviting us into that relationship of the Godhead, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So we have every possibility made, given to us through the life of the church, through the sacraments, through God's grace, to become holy, to become saints. That's what we are called to be. That is what God demands of us. So to know Christ means that we have to follow him faithfully. There are consequences to sin. Jesus points that out certainly in his gospel. For the people of Israel, people in Jerusalem, certainly they felt the sting of God's wrath, if you will, when the Chaldeans would come in and destroy Jerusalem and take their sacred objects away. When the Romans would come in and seize power. When the temple would be destroyed in the year 70. There are consequences to sin for us personally, certainly for a nation, and indeed as a church. As we celebrate this Eucharist, we ask our Lord for the grace to really be faithful, to not be content with a half-hearted Christianity, but that we might really be set on fire so that Christ is visible in us, that others come to know Christ because of you and his peace to you.
Christ.
the offerings of the church, O Lord, as she makes her prayer to you. Grant that when consumed by those who believe, they may bring ever greater holiness through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your heart.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is to be right and just, the duty of our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For just as through your beloved Son, you created the human race, so also through him, with great goodness, you formed it anew. And so it is right that all your creatures serve, all the redeemed praise you, and all your saints with one heart bless you. Therefore, we too extol you with all the angels as a joyful celebration we acclaim.
Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
You are the Holy of the Lord, the fount of all holiness. And holy, therefore, these gifts we pray, by sending down the Spirit of God like a dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. So that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and giving thanks to God, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you."
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done.
sparrow finds a home, and the swallow.